Good morning. Sorry for the late start, dictated by Washington's traffic, which is always worse when Congress is in session. So, Senator, when you go home, we'll have easier times getting around the street.
Duly noted. We'll get out of here.
I'm Doyle McManus of the Los Angeles Times. I'm today's moderator. Welcome to all of you today. We unusually have an on-the-record session, so you are all released from the council's draconian rules not to quote or cite. Our guest, as you know, is Senator Jeff Flake, the junior senator from Arizona. You have his biography. You know his biography. I'll just say two words about Senator Flake. As a native Californian, it is perplexing to all Californians to look at Arizona and notice that its legislators always punch above the weight of what appears to be us, to be a small state. Arizona has a history of producing members of Congress, especially of the Senate, who are conservative but fiercely independent and remarkably effective. You only have to think of Barry Goldwater and John McCain. And Jeff Flake, in many ways, follows in that tradition, but has already staked out some interesting ground of his own. He is still in his first term in the Senate, but served four terms in the House.
Six.
Six. How quickly time flies. Knows his way around. He is he is on the Foreign Relations Committee, of course, the ranking member of the Africa Committee, having spent serious time in Africa, in South Africa, Zimbabwe, and Namibia, and has done interesting work reaching across the aisle to Democrats, and has interesting positions and views on a range of foreign policy and domestic issues, and has a few words to start off with this morning. And so, Senator Flake, I'm going to give you the podium for about 10 minutes, and then we'll revert to our usual Q&A. I'll take 10 or 15 minutes and open it to the audience. Senator, thank you for being with us.
Thank you.
I appreciate the opportunity. I'm usually referred to or introduced as the other senator from Arizona. And you all know why. We have a more prominent senator, but Arizona has been a state now for 100 years, and we have only had 11 U.S. senators in 100 years. So they tend to serve prominently and for a long time, and I'll probably break that tradition but in terms of the prominence. But I appreciate this opportunity, and thank you, Doyle, and I want to thank the Council on Foreign Relations for this opportunity to discuss Congress's role in foreign policy. Now, my views on this issue, on foreign policy, haven't changed much. Having spent six terms in the House, but one benefit of this new position is that people now seem to be a little more interested in my position on these issues. That's one thing that comes, I guess, with the Senate. As Doyle mentioned, I cut my teeth in Southern Africa and watching Namibia become independent. I would live the political junkie's dream to be there when a country has its first election and writes its constitution. But international affairs has long captivated my interest. Having had a chance to serve on the House Committee on Foreign Affairs with such luminaries as Henry Hyde and Tom Lantos, I was grateful to have the chance to continue this work in the Senate. And in my view, Congress's role in foreign policy revolves around advancing three major goals. First and foremost, it's our job to protect U.S. national interests by reinforcing U.S. leadership abroad. Second, our national interest is best served when the U.S. promotes and supports principles of liberty and the democratic process abroad. And finally, just as with domestic policy, Congress has an obligation to protect U.S. taxpayers from wasteful or egregious spending in our foreign policy. With those as guiding principles, my efforts in foreign policy have sometimes led me down a different path than some of my colleagues, often against prevailing political winds. My efforts to modernize our U.S.-Cuba policy is just one example. I've long sought to remedy what I view as a backward policy. and lack of U.S. leadership by pushing for an end of our outdated Cuban economic embargo, an embargo that now represents 5 years of failed policy that has diminished the United States' role regionally. As I see it, ending the Cuban travel ban is not just, or the Cuba travel ban is not just a ending the travel ban is not a retreat, but rather a get-tough policy with the Cuban regime. I've often said, only half-jokingly, if we really want to punish the Castro brothers, just make them deal with spring break once or twice. We may see the white flag raised pretty quickly. But the ban on traveling to the island is at best a needless restriction on the freedom of U.S. citizens. And at worst, it treats various groups holding U.S. passports differently. Travel ban is difficult to square with promoting liberty for anybody. I will continue to work to see it lifted. And with headlines detailing a failed faux Twitter program with U.S. funds and a faux HIV clinic program run by USAID as cover for quasi-covert activities in Cuba. These activities, I should say, that diminish USAID's role around the world. U.S.-Cuba programming is clearly in need of some adult supervision. With Congress all but abdicating any role in the appropriation process, this kind of oversight is becoming increasingly difficult. Now, speaking of appropriations, this process has become more dysfunctional as time has gone on. To say that the process in Congress is broken is an understatement. The last time a foreign operations appropriation bill was signed into law as a standalone bill was 2005. At the same time, legislation to authorize foreign policy initiatives has often gone by the wayside. The House and Senate committees work on important measures, but it's rare that these ever come to the floor, let alone are signed into law. Instead, we leave it to appropriators to include riders in year-end omnibus spending measures, riders that cannot be amended or debated. Now, clearly, oversight is difficult under these terms. In addition, I think we can all agree that it's difficult to promote U.S. leadership and liberty abroad in a sustainable fashion without congressional input and effort. I think we can also all agree that with the threats we're seeing from the Middle East, to our interests as well as our allies, that the stakes have never been higher than they are today. Our position in the world is always stronger when Congress and the President present a united front. Unfortunately, it appears that the President will continue to undertake actions to combat ISIL without any official congressional authorization of the mission. Even worse, too many members of Congress have all but said they don't want to vote on it, at least not until after the elections. Now, since coming to Congress in 2001, I've noticed it seems Congress has been satisfied with abdicating more of its foreign policy role to the White House. In return, the White House is more than happy to circumvent Congress. Take, for example, the Strategic Partnership Agreement, meant to loosely define the relationship between the U.S. and Afghanistan in a period for 10 years, signed by President Obama and Afghan President Karzai in May of 2012. Among other things, this agreement includes promises that the executive branch will seek military and economic aid for Afghanistan from Congress. It also conferred on Afghanistan major non-NATO ally status. President Karzai sought the approval of the Loya Jirga for this agreement, and the Afghan National Assembly ratified the final strategic partnership agreement. Yet the Senate, our Senate, conducted no votes on this agreement. For the White House, I'm sure it's easy to treat the SPA as an executive agreement because it deprives the Senate of any chance to influence U.S. policy going forward in Afghanistan. The result is that we have no congressional buy-in, and It leaves the aid outlined in the SBA at the mercy of annual appropriators and the appropriations process that hasn't been working in Congress. That's no way to treat a strategic partner. But any vote on the strategic partnership agreement would be a hard one to take, and Congress has little appetite for tough votes these days. Last summer's debate on congressional authorization of strikes in Syria effectively demonstrated that reality. As we all recall, President Obama asked Congress to authorize the use of military force to degrade Bashar Assad's ability to wage war using chemical weapons. Now, none of us in Congress were consulted when the president announced in 2012 that the use of chemical weapons in Syria's civil war was a red line that would change his calculus on U.S. military involvement there. Yet we were put in the position of having to tell the president whether he could make good on his threat. I don't believe the president needed authorization from Congress to carry out the mission as it was described to us. And I voted in favor of the AUMF because I believe that to deny a president the authority to respond to a threat he previously made would damage American leadership and credibility. The purpose of seeking congressional authorization should not be to provide justification for not doing something that you said that you'd do. In this case, the lack of action helped prolong the status quo, and it has enabled ISIL to grow in strength. Further, the absence of leadership sent a powerful message to our allies and our adversaries alike that the United States doesn't always mean what it says. Now more than ever, we need to correct that message and reassert the United States as a world leader. We need to tell our allies in the region that the U.S. is going to help them defeat ISIL. What better way to do this than to vote to authorize the president or the mission that the president announced last week that our military will undertake? The president has said that he welcomes congressional support for the mission, but he didn't ask for it. And it appears there will be no push in either chamber to give it to him. Instead, we will consider providing authorization for funding for moderate elements of the Syrian opposition as part of a continuing resolution. The House will vote on that today, and the Senate likely tomorrow. The Senate Foreign Relations Committee approved a bill to do that same thing in May of 2013. More than a year ago, the House Foreign Affairs Committee authorized or advanced a similar bill in March of that same year. And so U.S. military action and efforts to combat ISIL in Iraq and Syria will be considered as business as usual. And Congress's silence on this will be deafening. The president needs to ask Congress for its support, and Congress needs to show it by way of a vote. I say this not because I believe the president is constitutionally bound to get Congress's approval. The question of where the president's foreign policy powers end and where Congress's began is left unanswered by the Constitution. I say this because securing the backing of Congress on any major foreign policy effort reinforces the United States leadership. It reassures our allies. Most importantly, sends a message to our adversaries that the United States is, in fact, united. History shows that when there is a threat to this nation and the president makes a good case for action, Congress will lend its support. The 2001 authorization for the use of military force in the wake of the September 11th attacks was approved by the House by a vote of 420-1. Similarly, the 2002 AUMF in Iraq was approved by both chambers with strong bipartisan support. Last week, the president himself said that the mission to combat ISIL will take time, and without a voice from this Congress to sustain and support him in this effort, I fear this critical mission will be subject to partisan attack for political gain in the months and years to come. Neither the president nor the Congress has demonstrated leadership in this effort, and the stakes are far too high to move forward without it. Switching gears for a minute, it's no secret I'm not a fan of egregious spending domestically or internationally. And during my House days, I fought some pretty lonely battles against wasteful and destructive earmarks. Foreign assistance, in my view, is critical and a necessary component of American diplomacy. It safeguards national security interests. But when that assistance is rife with waste, it undermines public confidence in the value of that assistance. I'm referring to things like the aforementioned Cuba debacles and other foreign assistance programs and projects that, while well-intended, are not sustainable beyond our mission in places like Afghanistan. We have a duty to be good stewards of the taxpayers' money while being mindful of our role in the world. Finally, let me say a couple of words about the role of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. It will come as no surprise that as one who spent 12 years in the House of Representatives running for re-election every 2 years, I think that the 6-year Senate term was the Founding Fathers' premier achievement. But the 6-year term's real importance lies not in giving senators a break from the semi-annual campaign grind. It allows senators individually and the Senate as an institution to look beyond the current administration, particularly in matters of foreign policy. That said, I don't think the Senate Foreign Relations Committee is maximizing its potential when it comes to its foreign policy role. Now, naturally, much of our time is spent authorizing programs, dealing with nominations, providing oversight for spending, and reacting to events that require our urgent attention, like those events today. But far too little time is spent probing and addressing the broader context and the trends in which our policies interact. Now, scholars from CFR and other organizations are discussing this broader context. There might not be a new world order, but I think we can all agree that the old order, upon which much of our foreign policy has been based and formulated, has been shattered. The Senate and the country would benefit if these discussions were brought from think tanks and editorial pages into the public arena. Now, in closing, if you ask me what I think the role in Congress in foreign affairs ought to be, I would say it is to ensure that we carry on the tradition of past generations of ensuring that our kids and grandkids can live and prosper in the greatest nation in the world. I would say that it is in our national interest to promote freedom and liberty abroad. I would say that we need to ensure that scarce resources are put to the highest possible use. But before all of that can happen, clearly Congress needs to actually want to have a role in the first place. Votes on foreign policy matters aren't always easy to take. They can often leave you politically exposed. But we are elected to Congress to take tough votes. And given the situation we find ourselves in today, it's my hope that we get back into that business. Thank you for having me here, and I look forward to questions that you might have. Can we move this back so we can see the whole room, or is that possible?
Just try.
There you go.
There's a senatorial initiative right there. Senator, thank you for that tour door zone. Let me take just a few minutes to frame a couple of questions, and then we will go swiftly to this hungry audience. And I want to start sort of on the big picture, on the themes you began and ended your remarks, which is the challenge of American strategy, American foreign policy. Many would call it the central challenge of American foreign policy in this era. You set out two or three priorities, big strategic goals: protecting U.S. national interests through leadership, continuing to promote democracy and liberty, but you also mentioned being a careful steward of scarce resources. And it seems to me, and not just me, but smarter people at the council like Steve Sestanovich and Richard Haass, that one of the central challenges we face is adjusting American strategy to an era of limits, of austerity. President Obama has addressed it by attempting to, in Steve Sestanovich's words, minimize our commitments abroad. What's your basic answer to squaring that circle? How do we maintain leadership while doing, or at least spending, less?
Well, I mean, there are several elements to effective leadership abroad. Only one is military. We've made liberal use of that over the past couple of decades. Regular statecraft and diplomacy has not been fully utilized, in my view. If we look at Iraq right now, and we continually say that there is no military solution, there has to be a political solution. If that is the case, then it seems to me we should have been more active on the political side during the past several years. Had a situation this morning, we learned that
You know, the parliament has rejected the interior and defense ministers that the new prime minister has put forward. It's going to be difficult, extremely difficult, to root out ISIL and to defend and stand up an Iraqi government just through military means if the political effort isn't there. So diplomacy needs to be there. Obviously, foreign aid will be an essential part of our diplomatic and foreign policy arsenal. But there are limits, and we have to make sure that we're careful stewards of that money, and we haven't been in certain circumstances. I would submit that a lot of our spending, some of it on the military side and elsewhere in Afghanistan, has not followed the model that we need to. So we simply have got to be more careful there, but that will always be a part of it. And then with regard to trade as well and economic development, that's another tool that we need to use more effectively, and that's why we need to move forward over the next year, make sure that we approve the TPP, for example, and give the president trade promotion authority. So we're just going to have to make more effective use of other elements in our arsenal rather than just military action.
And the defense budget as a basic proposition, are you comfortable with the direction it's heading?
Well, I think all of us have been troubled by Congress's inability to set priorities, which have necessitated kind of clumsy across-the-board cuts that have, in my view, probably diminished our military readiness more than it should. And so I hope that we get back to regular order where we can set these priorities. And that's going to involve, obviously, we've got to the biggest threat out there when I think it was Admiral Mullen was asked what keeps him up at night. He didn't say Iran and its military threat or anything else. He said the national debt, because unless we get that under control, nothing else we do matters much. We won't be able to fund a defense program or anything else. And so it's extremely important. But in order to do that, it has to be a more all-encompassing approach involving certainly entitlement spending. And now, we're going into a period, in my view, whether or not Republicans take control of the Senate, as a Republican, I hope we do, we will have divided government for the next 2 years. But keep in mind, over the past couple of decades, several decades, the only real reforms on the fiscal side that we've achieved have been with divided government. You have to have it, because no one party, if you control both chambers in the White House, will dare to make the tough choices with the midterms right around the corner. You have to have both parties buying in, and hopefully we'll have that scenario coming up soon. We need it.
Iraq and ISIL, are you satisfied that at this point we have clear goals and the right strategy?
I'm sure, the goals are certainly there. The strategy, I'm concerned that that we haven't been as effective on the diplomatic side and putting the pressure on the political side that we need to. It's going to be very difficult to have a sustainable situation without an inclusive government in Baghdad. And the news today continues to be that that's a long way off. And so I hope that we continue to say there's no military solution here. That's certainly an element that has to be there. If that is the case, we need to be more effective and active on the political front, on the diplomatic front.
On a tactical level, General Dempsey yesterday introduced the proposition that under some circumstances he might recommend to the president that American combat troops operate with Iraqis as close combat advisors, not necessarily as direct combatants. Are you comfortable with that prospect?
Well, I'm certainly comfortable that we have admitted we're considering that strategy. If our Pentagon, if the military brass has not been considering all options, they aren't doing their job. And I think that his voicing of that opinion is simply recognizing reality that those are options that are that are out there. So I think anybody who's looked at this deeply, that was no surprise. And we have about 1,600, whether you call them boots on the ground or not, people embedded, perhaps not in the front lines, but helping the military. And it only makes sense that we have considered the possibility. I, like everyone, hopes that we don't have to go there. But I'm glad that the Pentagon is thinking about it.
Well, the president has in effect staked out a red line of U.S. of no U.S. combat role on the ground. Is that appropriate, or is that an option that should stay open?
Well, we haven't done too well with red lines in the past, and this is one that I think we'll get ourselves in trouble if we emphasize too much. Our success depends on the ability to assemble an effective coalition, particularly among regional players, more so than we've had before. And they have to be convinced that we're in it to win it. And so I think drawing red lines here or there or everywhere limits our ability to put together effective coalitions.
And finally, you talked with vigor and passion about your view that Congress ought to be authorizing this action in Iraq and Syria, ought to be debating this action. Yes, as you say, the president has said he would be happy to have it, but doesn't need it and hasn't asked for it. But last time I looked, there's nothing to prevent members of Congress from introducing and pressing for a debate on authorization themselves. I sometimes feel these days if we collected the names of all the members of Congress who said, you know, we ought to be debating and authorizing this, you might have a working majority already. So how come that ain't happening?
That's a good point. And when I say that the president ought to ask for it and Congress ought to provide it, I'm being critical of both. Right now, the president, I think, should be more forceful in saying this is in our national interest, because this is a mission that is of necessity going to outlast my time in the White House. This is a critical mission that is going to have to endure longer than he's around, and it only makes sense that we'll be more effective if we present a united front. But like I said, my colleagues simply say, let's not do anything the president hasn't asked for, and it's at least not until after the election. And I think that's just the wrong approach to take, and that kind of mirrors the approach we've taken in Congress in general, just not taking tough votes. The dysfunction in the Senate, more than anything else, is rooted in the unwillingness of the majority, and I'm not just blaming this majority. We were trending this direction when Republicans were in the majority, the reluctance or unwillingness to take tough votes. And as I said, a six-year term is a wonderful thing, especially after being in the House. But with that ought to come the responsibility to take tough votes. You have a little longer time to explain them, and we just haven't done that in the Senate.
Let's give the audience a chance. There are lots of pent-up questions here, sir.
Thank you. Good morning, Senator. Will Davis with the United Nations Development Program here in Washington. I know Washington officials hate hypothetical questions, but you've already touched on the potential change in control of the Senate, so maybe I can tempt you. As a potential chairman of the Africa Subcommittee on the Foreign Relations Committee, what priorities might you pursue to help reinvigorate the Foreign Relations Committee role in shaping U.S.-Africa policy?
Well, thanks. And by the way, on Africa, I was pleased to see the president stand yesterday and talk about a more robust role for the U.S. government in combating Ebola. I spoke to Liberian president yesterday. They're extremely appreciative, and I think it was the right thing to do. With regard to Africa, as mentioned, I spent time there in the early 80s, and then in the late 80s again. I love the continent, and I have enjoyed seeing so many countries move ahead and grow economically and otherwise. And the U.S. role, it is underappreciated how appreciated the U.S. role was, particularly with the AIDS crisis there with PEPFAR. We gained a lot of goodwill. I know the motivation was to save lives, and that it did, and made life better for a lot of individuals and countries. But it certainly enhanced our ability to influence the direction of policy in Africa by being involved. And I applaud the President, President Bush, for doing that. President Obama's power initiative that has been pushed is a good thing. I would hope that we can expand on that. What I hope we do is actually with regard to Africa and power, and that is the main impediment to development in many of these countries, that we keep in mind that that is the primary goal, not to push some kind of energy agenda on Africa, but actually allow them and help them develop their economies through power. So that's a big initiative. And then overall with trade, we've got AGOA that has been useful in helping some of these countries develop. But there's real competition in many African countries between which model to go, and China has been very active. All things equal, most of these African countries and private sector businesses and others that we deal with would rather deal with U.S. businesses or with the U.S. government than China. China tends to bring in personnel and employment. It's much more sustainable if it's done with the U.S. or with the West. And so I think that we need to be more active there. I've been pleased with the caliber of ambassadors that go to Africa. We approve those nominations. With Africa, it's mostly career service employees or State Department employees, and that's a good thing. And so I think we've done some good things over the past decade. We've got to continue to respond to things like Ebola and also the crisis in Central African Republic and South Sudan, but also look beyond and look at trade and sustainable development.
We have a question in front here.
Thanks. Welcome to the Council, Senator. I'm Steve Charnovitz. I'm a professor at George Washington University. And I teach in the international trade area and wanted to thank you for your leadership. You're one of the few in the Congress that actually says you believe in international trade and you've worked hard on free trade. You talked about Cuba and our 50-year-long embargo, which has not been very effective. And I'm wondering what you think of the strategy of Cuba bringing a case against the United States at the WTO. Right now in the Congress, there's not much chance of changing our current law. But other countries have brought cases against the United States at the WTO and won, like Antigua or Malaysia or many countries around the world. And clearly our embargo against Cuba violates WTO law. So I wonder if you think it would be helpful for Cuba to bring a case against the United States in the WTO court and see if that can change the political dynamics in the United States.
No, I don't. I don't think that, that would be productive if Cuba were to bring such a case, and it would be a ruling in their favor. And I don't think there would be, but it would do nothing but push Congress the other way. That's my own view. I simply think that we're coming to a point. I would have hoped we would have been here a long time ago, but where the prevailing political winds have shifted, the majority of Cuban Americans in Florida favor certainly lifting the travel ban and increased contact and commerce, and they're doing it. There were about 400,000 visits of Cuban Americans to Cuba in the past year. With the lifting of the ban on remittances or limits on remittances, money is going to Cuba that is being used outside of, to the extent that it can be, more outside of government control to allow entrepreneurs to develop. Now, this is far less likely to be dialed back. It's more difficult for the government to dial progress like this back. So I wouldn't favor that strategy. I just hope that we in Congress can realize we're behind the times and can shift pretty quickly here.
Let me follow on that. Can you see a political way there in the next Congress if there is a Republican majority?
That's a difficult one. The way the Helms-Burton law is structured, it makes it difficult for the president to do too much or for Congress to do too much without genuine political change in Cuba, regardless of whether this might foster that change more quickly. I would argue it would. So I think that that's a difficult proposition. The president can do more by further liberalizing people-to-people contact and whatnot in terms of travel. I think he has done so. The irony is, during my early years in the House, I was able to pass legislation on an appropriation bill to lift the travel ban or not provide funding to enforce the travel ban. Passed that a couple of times. It was identical language in the Senate. Could not get President Bush to sign it. Now we could get President Obama to sign it, and I can't pass it. So it's kind of tough there. But I think progress is being made. The Cuban government is all about control. They want to control visitors who come. If we lifted our travel ban, I have no doubt that they would impose their own restrictions because they want the money that comes with travel, not the influence. But if somebody's going to limit my travel, it ought to be a communist. that's more their province. We shouldn't be in the business of limiting American travel.
We have some questions on this side of the room, sir.
You probably don't get too many questions on Namibia. I'm Reed Kramer from All Africa, allafrica.com. But I have one that has broader foreign policy implications. As you no doubt know, Namibia is coming to the end of a Millennium Challenge compact, which has been directed at upgrading their educational system, training teachers, and also building up their tourism to in a way that promotes jobs and as well as national income. They're not eligible for a renewal because they are now classified as a middle-income country. The middle income comes from the fact that there's a very wealthy white population as a vestige of the apartheid years. And the Namibians feel they are being punished for their success. And I'm wondering, MCC has been a very widely welcomed program on a bipartisan basis, started under the Bush administration. But I'm wondering if this is something you think should be addressed in the way they do their business.
I'd have to look at it specifically, but at some point, countries do graduate, if you will, and move on to other trade and investment regimes. So I wouldn't automatically say, well, hey, just because I'm fond of Namibia and want to see it succeed, that it's appropriate and proper to change the rules so they can continue. I would see it as a plus that they're moving out of that category, however it's defined. And there are obviously scarce resources in the MCC. And so I'd have to look at it and see. But I wouldn't rule it out, but wouldn't automatically support it.
In the middle of the room, sir.
Alan Wendt used to be with the State Department. Senator, in the front page of the Washington Post, there's a small item. Israel's West Bank settler population is showing signs of robust growth. The United States has traditionally opposed expansion of settlers in the West Bank. What is your view of the situation? Does our opposition go beyond rhetoric? What should we do?
Well, that's an extremely thorny and difficult issue, and has been a major impediment to long-term agreements moving ahead. And I wouldn't want to signal what formula we have to employ or abide by there. have some resolution. I would say work with the Israeli government and also the PA, and I wouldn't want to insert myself there and decide how many of the settlements can stay and which ones have to be moved. I think that's a product of negotiation between the government and the PA and the international community.
The issue is expansion.
Right. Well, I think that we've had enough to say on that regard, and I think it's going to be very difficult to have the kind of solution that we've outlined that we support with expansion of the settlements.
Ma'am.
Thank you. I'm Christina Tsafoulias with the Embassy of Switzerland. I wanted to touch on another hotspot, Ukraine, and to ask you, are you comfortable with the role that the U.S. has been playing in that conflict so far and with the cooperation that's been happening with the European Union as far as incrementally increasing sanctions? Or do you think that this is sort of an area in which the U.S. could increase its leadership and also assert U.S. national priorities?
Well, thank you. I think we all recognize that unless Europe is willing to move more quickly and with more force, the news just in the last 48 hours or so in terms of the agreement struck in the East shows that Europe is not ready to move ahead. I think the role of the U.S. ought to be to work with our allies, particularly the Europeans, and to have a stronger response. I think a united effort there is needed. I'm not sure that we can get out in front of our European allies there too far. We want as much as possible in this and another crisis to be in a position where it's whether it's with Iran and their nuclear program, whether it's Iran versus the West rather than Iran versus the U.S. The same applies here. We need to work with our allies, perhaps more forcefully, but along with our allies to convince them to have a more robust program to deter Russian involvement there.
Yeah, please.
Julia Chang Block, President of the U.S.-China Education Trust. Given your deep interest in Africa, your seeming passion for Cuba, and your commitment to free trade, I wonder if you think that it is the best way to protect our national interests by investing the bulk of our treasure in blood and in money on the Middle East. Maybe we have no choice, but I would like your views.
Mm-hmm. Well, I would put myself in the "we have no choice" camp. This is something that's been thrust upon us, as I mentioned in my speech. I don't believe, and I'm anxious to read Henry Kissinger's new book about the New World Order. I think we can all agree that there's no new world order. The old one is gone, and certainly in the Middle East, and we're going to be dealing with that legacy and trying to put together some kind of new structure or help those countries with a new structure for a long time. And so I just don't see any way around investing time, resources, and in some cases, blood in order to protect our own national interest. I wish it were otherwise, but I don't see a choice at this point.
Let me follow up with a slightly different way of framing the question. Are we in an era where the United States doesn't have the bandwidth, the resources, whatever factors it needs to be able to do both of these things, to try and stabilize the Middle East while also rebalancing toward Asia and giving due attention toward Africa and Latin America?
No, that's a good point. Obviously, we can and have multitasked in the past. With regard to trade and investment, with the exception of some government programs we have, MCC or other preferential trade agreements, these are things that we just need to push forward and agree to rather than fund. And I would put the TPP in that category. That's one where we've got to move forward. I've been very disappointed that the White House has not made that more of a priority. That's one where Republicans in Congress will provide most of the votes for. We just need a more concerted effort, not just rhetoric, but effort by the administration to push that deal. We've got, over the past three decades, I think we've only had one trade agreement with Jordan, I believe, and that had more to do with defense than commerce, without giving the president trade promotion authority. He's got to have it. Congress needs to give it to him, but the administration is going to have to be more active in asking for it. So I think that we can do both. We can certainly have a free trade agenda that we pursue more vigorously while we're dealing with these other crises.
Come back to this side of the room, sir.
Name's Reggie Love, Transatlantic Holdings. You had two good points, a little unrelated. One, on the Power Africa initiative, you mentioned that we shouldn't push policy on the countries in terms of what types of generation they look to use. Do you think, are there any ties that the U.S. should put on power generation or types based off of what we're currently seeing in our complicated energy markets and on power generation? And then on another question about, as a ranking member on the Foreign Relations Committee, with as many countries, I read something the other day, there were like 55 ambassadors who haven't been appointed or something. Do you think that there should be a bigger push from you and your colleagues to help alleviate that problem, given that some of those posts are in regions that sort of need it?
Okay. Well, thank you. And on that last question first, I think that we ought to be, we ought to work faster and be more accommodating. Where I have jurisdiction over Africa, we move those through pretty quickly, and they're typically non-controversial. They're career foreign service, and not as much controversy there. For my part, I meet with all of them. We push the hearings as quickly as we can and try to move them ahead. With regard to the Power Africa initiative, I refer, when I say we shouldn't be pushing an agenda, we have a carbon cap issue that we have waived in annual appropriation bills, but that doesn't do much for the long term. And for sustainability or certainty moving ahead. And it really complicates the ability of these countries and private sector interests in these countries to, you know, move capital where they need to and to form the kind of partnerships they need to, with this cap possibly being there the next year. And so that's what I'm referring to specifically. I think that we need to obviously be concerned about long-term where they get their power, but more than anything, we need to help them develop their own resources and recognize they aren't in the same place that we are or other developed countries are. And we ought to be more concerned about actually helping them develop their economies than perhaps some of these policies allow.
So. I've been neglecting the back of the room, sir.
Hi there, Mark Jacobson. I'm a former Senate Armed Services Committee staffer, and I currently teach a course at the George Washington University on Congress and U.S. foreign policy. I want to follow up on something Reggie pointed out, and that's the this idea that a lot of nominations, especially for career ambassadors, are being held up. The Senate Armed Services Committee, I think, does a laudable job at getting the flag and general officers, who require a certain degree of scrutiny, through without the politics. And I'm wondering to what degree you could see the committee building upon the success you spoke about and treating the non-career nominations almost in bulk. Have the hearings, but get them through without slowing things down for some of the controversial non-career appointees. Related to that, how can you convince your colleagues in the House and some of your colleagues in the Senate that it's important to get abroad the way that you have and travel, not just on a CODEL to run around and see what the U.S. is doing, but truly understand the world in a time when their constituents often think of trips overseas as junkets. You know, I'd encourage them to go to Riga in December or something like that and find out it's not that much of a junket. But I worry about that. I worry about Congress truly understanding the world if it's simply staying in Washington, D.C. in the home districts.
Well, thank you. Your first question about moving these nominations through. You know, it's interesting. When I was in the House, I would look at the Senate and think, boy, it would be nice if we in the House had advised and consent. We could weigh in on ambassadorial nominations and Supreme Court appointments and district judges. And when I got to the Senate, I just didn't realize that would be all I would be doing. Regular legislation just hasn't moved. But I, for one, my own philosophy has been the president ought to have his picks unless there is an extraordinary reason otherwise. And so I voted for many whom I haven't agreed with philosophically or otherwise. But I think the president ought to have his pick. I can tell you that with the employing of the nuclear option, it really poisoned the well here, and it made it difficult for Republicans to just take that and not slow up other things. And I hope that when we get into the new Congress, that we get beyond this silliness. My own view in general, just on the kind of the broader topic of where the Senate is going. I love the traditions and customs of the Senate, particularly the fact that virtually everything is done by unanimous consent or a large enough supermajority that requires and enables more comity and cooperation. That's been the traditional Senate. I fear that if we have this dysfunction much longer, that it won't hold, that people will come in with proposals to expand the nuclear option to regular legislation. The Senate will become a pale version of the House, and those who enacted those changes will be applauded for it, because it's that as opposed to the complete dysfunction that we see now. And so I hope that we can get together. I'm participating, as are others, in small groups trying to find a way forward, whether it's by small rule changes or behavioral changes mostly, where we can get the Senate working again, not just to approve nominees more quickly, but to actually consider and amend legislation on the floor and let the votes fall where they may. It was pointed out the other day, and this is significant, Judge Bork, Clarence Thomas, Judge Alito, Judge Roberts, all came to the floor. It wasn't whether they were approved or not in the case of Bork. It wasn't by filibuster. You had some of the most controversial things that have come forward. And just not too long ago, that was an up or down vote, because not too long ago, people would not have considered using a 60-vote threshold to block this kind of thing. And we've just got to get back to that in the Senate. With regard to travel, I've always felt that you ought to get around. and I mean, when you have a role in Congress a role for oversight for foreign aid or with embassy security or to travel to a war zone or for whatever reason, it's money well spent to go around the world and see what we're doing and what we're involved in. And for a time there, it was popular for some members of Congress to say, I don't even have a passport. You know, it's kind of a badge of honor at home. And I just never saw it that way. But it comes sometimes at a political price. In my last Senate campaign, I had a primary challenge. Person spent about $9 million in the primary, and his first ad was, he had noted that in my 12 years in the House, I had traveled to 39 countries, and he had a, you know, a little cartoon Flake air up there, and he had a scrolling list of the countries I'd gone to, and I quickly took a look at it, and I knew the guy I was running against. I sent him a text. I said, "You forgot Lesotho, Morocco, Iraq, and one other." And the next week, they changed the ad and added those four countries. So anyway, you sometimes can't win for losing there. But I've always felt it's something that's, you know, tough to explain sometimes at home in some audiences, but it's worth it. You just do it because it's needed, and not just official CODEL travel, but you know, go off to a deserted island sometimes. You know?
We haven't gotten into that. We've been very restrained on that subject.
We have my time. Staff will thank you.
This may be one of the few audiences in Washington that will not explore that, but we'll wait for later. We have time for just two last very quick questions. Sir.
Tom Dine, Middle East Broadcasting and Freedom House. You've used this morning, Senator, words like United Front or Unity. That politicians don't like to be politically exposed, tough votes, et cetera. So a very tough issue, but an important one, is both domestic and foreign, like trade, and that is immigration. How did we not ask an Arizona senator about immigration? Please tell us your views, and how can we help unify the nation on this particular subject?
Well, thank you. When I was in the House, I put forward several immigration reform proposals. When I got to the Senate, I just didn't expect to join a gang so quickly. I thought that I left gang life behind after the mean streets of Snowflake, Arizona, you know. But I got there and quickly moved with four Democrats and four Republicans in the so-called Gang of Eight to draft the immigration bill. And let me add, that was one exception, one example where the Senate acted like it used to act. A bipartisan group drafted a bill over about 7 months, introduced it, took it to the Judiciary Committee, amended it 140 some times, took it to the Senate floor, amended it again, and passed it on a bipartisan basis. And I hope we can do more of that. But specifically with regard to immigration, coming from Arizona, I've seen where a state and communities have paid a disproportionate price because of the federal government's failure, not just to secure the border, but to have a rational policy when it comes to immigration. And it's a difficult issue politically at home. Get you primaried and everything else to come out in favor of broad-based immigration reform, but we need it desperately. Not only do we need a more secure border, that's self-evident, we need to have a change our legal immigration structure moving ahead and make sure that we have access to the skilled immigration. I introduced in the House something called the Staple Act. Basically, if you have a degree from a U.S. university in any of the STEM fields, we ought to staple a green card to your diploma. And that was largely adopted as part of the Gang of Eight bill. But on the low-skill side, too, we're going to have needs that aren't filled now. We have to move ahead in terms of policy. And if that's not enough to convince Republicans, we ought to look at the politics of it and realize that we have to deal with this issue politically if we want to win national elections. And it's not just to appeal to the largest growing demographic, Hispanics, although that's important. I view it that whether you're Hispanic or any other group, they expect a national party, well, the national parties, to have a rational policy moving ahead. And if we can't do that, we're not just losing Hispanic votes, we're losing votes across the spectrum. And I just think that we've got to deal with this issue first and foremost for policy reasons, And second, as a Republican, I hope we deal with it for political reasons as well. So.
It's an iron rule of the council that we end on time, even if we have started a few minutes late. So I'm going to apologize to those to whom I on whom I couldn't call. You're free to try and ambush the senator on his way out. Let me remind you that at variance with the usual council rules, this meeting was on the record, so you are solemnly admonished to repeat what you've heard here and to give credit for the good ideas to Senator Flake, and I hope you will join me in thanking him for the time he spent with us.
Thank you. Appreciate it.